before you and open our hearts to receive from you. In your heavenly name, amen.
If you believe in spiritual warfare, pray over our tech. A warm welcome. I'm Jonathan, and I'm one of the pastors here. I'm going to be speaking in a little while. I just want to give you a heads up. They're just going to try and figure out what's happening. So what's happened recently is we've had a piece of kit just break down and fail on us completely. So instead of all of our sound coming out of our computer, beautifully going into the great sound system in the church, that thing failed, and we're waiting for a new part to come. So for the last few weeks, we've been limping. We've just been limping and limping with sound just coming out of that tiny thin speaker on the projector so that if I sing loudly, I drown it out. And today, instead of limping, we've fallen completely over. And so they're going to struggle to see if we can get some sound. So here's a head up. A little bit later, I was going to give some space and some time for us to share some testimonies together of the good things God has done. In our reading today, we're going to read, it gets to the end, and it talks about the incredible things, or marveling at the incredible things that God has done, God's great power at work in us. So we were going to give a bit of space later on after a warning that there'd be some time to share some testimony, just a little story of some of the good things that God is doing. We're going to move that up the order a little bit. And so instead of doing it later, I'm going to encourage us to do it now. So I wonder if anybody has got a great story of things that have happened recently, of what God has been doing in their lives or in the lives of people around them. Perhaps in that network of friends and relatives and associates and neighbors that you've been praying for and working with. Susanna's going to go first. Come on, Susanna.
Come on. This is a second-hand testimony about a friend of ours, some of you have been praying for, called Chris. We put it down prayer web. Chris is a dear friend who's in his early 50s, which is young, isn't it? And he's a fitness fanatic and does ultramarathons and runs, you know, around the coast path of Cornwall and all this kind of crazy stuff. Really fit guy. And he was riding his bike in town and came off. This was in Northampton about 2 weeks ago. And he flew 30 feet through the air, collided with three cars, and, yeah, was a complete mess. Now, we all know what the NHS is like at the moment. The guy in the car behind him was a medic. The ambulance came within 5 minutes. The air ambulance came within 30 minutes, and he was in the specialist head injuries hospital within an hour in Coventry. And I just think that in itself is a miracle. He was in a really bad way, and we were all praying and praying and praying, and things looked bleaker and bleaker. And last Friday, they said, it's time to come in and say goodbye. We're going to harvest the organs. We're going to turn off the life support. This is the end. And we didn't understand that. Why did he do all that? Why did God provide all that if he was going to die? And then miraculously, having them signed all the paperwork, you know, the transplant nurses were literally at the door to come and get the stuff. I mean, it was that close. A neurologist who'd not been in for a week appeared and said, stop, I know, I did they do a special kind of scoring thing when a head injury comes in to see what the brain functions like at the beginning, because it then deteriorates, but those initial readings are really important. And he said, I did the readings. They were a lot higher than what they are now. You need to stop. And it felt like the cruelest thing, because, you know, you've just said goodbye to somebody and then they're saying you've got to wait. And so they waited and they didn't know what was going to happen. And anyway, I saw his wife on Friday, and he, on Thursday or Friday, he was awake. He was off the ventilator. They'd sat him up by the side of the bed for half an hour. He still needs aid with his breathing, and he can't speak, can't really move, but can respond to commands with his eyes, which is a really good indication. And it also looked like he kind of got a joke, which made it seem like actually Chris is still there, you know. And so the rehab is going to be a really long journey, but his son is calling him Lazarus now, because it was like, you know, those 3 days it happened, it was like all hope was gone. But so I just wanted to testify and ask you to keep praying, but God is amazing, and he is a God who heals, and it's not Chris's time yet.
Amen. Amen. Isn't God good? God is very good. Any other testimonies of things that God has been doing in our lives or the lives of our friends, relatives, associates, neighbors? Now, guys, is that Jan? Come on, Jan. I thought a hand. Were you putting a hand up or were you just waving at me? Okay. That's a shame, because Jan has great testimonies. So, guys, do we think we're there?
Yes, we think so.
We think so. This is going to be fun. Is it coming through here, or what's happening? Let's give it a try. Let's see what we're up to. If this works, I'll sit down. If not, some of you better come up with a really good testimony quick. Okay.
Thank you. time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Okay, it's good when we can just deal with what we have to deal with. We can worship him, whether the words match what we're hearing, doesn't matter. Thank goodness it's all beautiful to him. So, Ruth, do you want to come and do a notice about Hospitality Month, which will ring some bells for those of you that have been here for a while?
Okay, so I'm just going to introduce Hospitality Month. I've got a little display over there. So during coffee time, if you want to go and have a look at some photographs from previous years when we've done Hospitality Month. So Hospitality Month is for the congregation to kind of get to know one another a little bit better. It's a little bit of fun, and it's just for the congregation. If you've got, obviously got friends who you want to come in as well, that's absolutely fine. So it's like a little bit of evangelism as well, in the fact that if you're doing an event, you can invite whoever you want to the event. So just an example, because some of you won't know what it is. So basically we're asking people in the church to come up with an event. So it might be a small event, it could be a big event, it's up to you. So it might be like coffee and cake at somebody's house on a certain day at a certain time. And on the display boards over there, we'll have a list of all the events, and then you just sign up to whatever you want to go to. So it's good if it's somebody who you didn't know, because then you're going to get to know somebody a bit better. If you're new, wow, you're going to have a field day. So Hospitality Month is in October, but you need to be thinking about it from now, because October, even though this is the summer holidays, I know people are away for a week or 2 weeks, and then suddenly it's September, and then bam, it's in October. So if you start thinking about something that you could do, it can be just for two people, it could be for four people. You could say Sunday lunch at the Hercules' house on a certain day, and then you sign up and come to that. So basically it's getting to know one another in the church. Because I think some people sit on this side of the church and they know that those people. Some people sit on this side and know those people. So it's good to cross over and find a new friend from church. So that's the idea. Any questions? Does that make sense? If you're part of this church and you've had a church email, it will actually on the email on Thursday, I think I sent it out. So if you want to know any more information, come and speak to me or Tyrone. Have a look at the photographs at coffee time. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any birthdays or family news? We are quite thin. No. Oh. Elijah. Thank you, Elijah. It was my birthday last week. Have a round of applause. That's exciting. Any other? No? Okay, how's it doing at the back with tech? Excellent, we're going to try and sing. Well, we'll try. Okay, we are going to have a time of prayer. Time to just sit and reflect. I was sat in our garden this morning and looking at my pots of plants and just remembering how lacking we are with rain at the moment, we're all aware. There was a little rain shower last night and I got really excited. And then how long did it last? About 3 seconds. And I'm just, especially at the moment, aware that each rain shower brings hope. It brings hope that it will quench the thirst of our ground, our lawns that look dry, our plants that look a bit weary and drooping. And when it was really hot, I was watering a couple of my pots twice a day because I really didn't want them to die off. And it made me realize that our hearts can be like this, that sometimes we're well watered and we're fertile and we're so deeply rooted that a lack of rain doesn't matter. And then there's times like now when there is no rain and our struggles fail to be quenched almost because there's just nothing, there's not enough. There's not enough water or rain coming in. And then occasionally there's what I like to describe as my pots, which is I think where I am really. And they get a bit droopy towards the end of the day. And you give them a drink and they perk up. And you look out in the morning and they're looking a bit more happy. But in some ways that isn't enough. It's not enough to just drip feed ourselves. And so I just wanted to have some time for us to just sit really and to receive and to let God minister to us where we are, whether you're feeling really well watered or fine or very unwatered. And just to give God your struggles and your hopes and your dreams and know that he hears everything. It doesn't matter where we're at. And I just want you to sit and let him rain on you in the way that only he can, because he knows where you're at, and that's the beauty of it. And he can water our hearts in whatever way he thinks they need to be watered. Not how we think they need to be watered, but whatever way he wants to. And so I just want you to invite you. I'm going to turn the mic off, and I'm just going to give you some time, and then I'll come back. But I just want you to just sit and reflect. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
I'm going to read and share from the scripture in just a minute, but just before I do, Chris, during the worship, Chris is just feeling the Lord is speaking to him about something. So Chris, I want you just to share briefly what that was, and it may be that what Chris shares is something that you want to follow up with him or I afterwards, that's fine, but I just want to give space when the Spirit's moving for that. So Chris, why don't you just share what the Lord placed on your heart just then?
Hello? Yeah. I was just, when I was praying, I got this feeling that there is. We often stand in the desert where there's no rain, and we look and we think, "Is this real?" And one of the things in my life is that's been part of what I had to do all my life because I'm a scientist as well. I've been an engineering scientist for a very long time, but one of the things that struck me, and it just came to me from the words from God's word. Right at the beginning, God says, "You shall have no one else before me, and you are not to make any likenesses of me." So right there, God is telling us to worship in spirit. And then he goes through the whole of the Bible. The whole history of the Bible is written up for us, right from the time of the beginning, Adam and Eve, and all the rest of it. And as we explore science today, all of these truths, everywhere the Bible touches a human historical moment, we find proof of that in the history and the archaeology. And every time someone rises up and goes against this and wants to destroy the Bible, they just find out that the Bible's real. And everywhere, two things happen in the Bible. The one thing is this spiritual worship that God commands from us. And the second thing is where it touches the world in history, where the Egyptians, the time of Egypt, all of that history is a reality. And everywhere the Bible touches human existence, it's real and it can be proven. And throughout that, he's telling us about Jesus. And Jesus comes, and what does he do? He says, "I will release the Holy Spirit to you." So all of this is real for us. The problem is there's no other religion like that. All other religions have like a limitation of existence, but they don't have a history of reality written into them so that that can go. And I just felt this morning that I should tell somebody that because we struggle with that. We all, somewhere along the line, we go to the we are in the desert, and we must think back and we must realize that there is no other word as real as the Bible that we study. And I think that that is, we sometimes lose that because we study the Bible and we can't get the reality of it. But that reality is absolutely proven throughout the Bible. And it can't be anything but supernatural for it to have been. There's no other book, no other books in the whole world that have been preserved for that amount of time with such consistency. So it wasn't written today. It was written, this Bible was written 4,000 years ago. It was started and it was written. And it declares the history of the world. And who's in that history? God all the way. Thank you.
I said, Chris, just share it briefly so that if someone needs to follow up, they can. He just said to me, "I'm sorry, that wasn't very brief." But it was fine, Chris. Thank you. And it may well be that you're here today, and that's where you're at, that kind of wrestling, like, is this true? Can I trust this? I'm coming because my parents brought me, because I've always come, because my friends brought me today. Can I trust this? And we want to say it is utterly reliable, utterly trustworthy. And if you need to just chat to find out more, then you can. I said earlier, the space for sharing some testimony. And I wonder if anybody else has some testimony they wanted to share before we jump into our Bible reading. I want to give you a chance because I promised there would be a chance. So is that you? Okay. Well then, if you have your Bibles handy, turn them on or open them up to Luke chapter 5. We're going to look at one of the great stories. I love this story, and it tells us so much. And we're just going to think of a couple of things that might be helpful to us that we can apply almost immediately from this story. So, chapter 5, and we're going to start reading at verse 16. No, we're not going to finish at 16. We're going to start at verse 12. I need a bigger print Bible than even my giant print Bible that I'm using. Dear me. So we're going to read from Luke chapter 5, from verse 12. Here we go. Do you know, I really need to check my glasses out even better. Let's go from verse 17 instead. Let's go from verse 17 instead. Definitely verse 17. Okay. Otherwise, it's a whole. I started to read it and thought, I haven't prepared a sermon on that text. One day, Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Samaria and Jerusalem, And the power of the Lord is with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they couldn't find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd right in front of Jesus. We're going to stop there. Okay, so here's the scenario, friends. Jesus is at a house, and there's a very good chance that it's Jesus' own house, that Jesus is at home. And people know where he lives. It's a very good chance this is at Jesus' house. And while he's there, he's in his house. So I want you to imagine Jesus sitting here in his house. Who should we have be a Jesus for us for a second? Ty, could you come and be Jesus for me for a minute? Is that okay? Not qualified. Just read Hebrews. You'll find out you really are. It's okay. Just sit there. So here's Jesus, and he's teaching in his house. And the front door is like over there where our front door is. And imagine that every single one of these chairs is a person sitting, listening to Jesus teach. Do you want to teach for a while? We'll just... Yes. Okay, I'll let you off. I'll let you off.
Wine into water.
Wine into water. Do we like this Jesus who turns wine into water? The teetotal Jesus, there we go. But imagine there's no aisle here, but this is full of people too. And they're crammed in. They're all around Jesus. And Jesus is here teaching. And the crowd is here. They're pressing in. And they're so full. Like, I mean, his house really wasn't this big. So don't imagine Jesus had a huge house like this. But imagine, here's Jesus at the front and pressing in all around him where all these chairs are. There's people. And then out here, there's some folks arriving. And they're arriving late. They're arriving late because they've been carrying a very heavy burden. And they get to the door. And they're a heavy burden, and it's their friend who is paralyzed. Things about Jesus. Don't worry, the guys in the sound desk are annoyed with me now. I'm messing up the sound. They've heard all these things about Jesus. They've heard that he's amazing, that he's healing people, that people come to him who've had physical illnesses and they get well, people who've had spiritual problems and they find that they're suddenly healed, people who others wouldn't talk to, who've been outcasts from society, and they find that Jesus loves them. And so that's why there's this huge crowd. They want to get close to Jesus, but these guys, they've brought their friend. Their friend who can't walk, who's on like a mat, a pallet type thing, a bit of a structure that he would sit on, and they've been carrying him, a bit like somebody on a stretcher and you take them off the football pitch. And there's these friends and they come with their mate, but when they get to the door, they find they can't get in. They can't get in. There's a problem. The crowd is just so big that they cannot get in. Now, in the time of Jesus, houses were built a little differently than they are for us today. Okay, and so in the time of Jesus, you would have a house that had a room, a big room in it, and almost everything would happen in that one room. So you'd sleep in that room, you'd eat in that room, you'd cook in that room, you'd live in that room. There might be another room off to the side for another family member, an older member to sleep perhaps, but basically it all happened in this one room. If you were a tradesperson, you had attached to your building another room where you would do your trade, unless it was a trade that could be done in that room, in which case you'd be doing it in that room. And so Jesus is teaching and he's here. It's very likely that there was a room off to one side or a whole new entrance off to one side that would have had a workshop in there because Jesus was a carpenter, or even general builder, we're not entirely sure, but that sort of a thing, worked with his hands and he was a builder. So he had a room where he would have been doing some of his work. Now, here's the very big, important difference between houses in the time of Jesus and houses today. And that is, at the side of this room or at the side of the building, there would have been steps up. And the steps would have gone up onto the roof. It would be a flat roof. And up on that roof, you might sit in the cool of the evening. You might cook, you might eat, you might spend time with friends. You might, if you were very rich, start to build a second floor. You might have a second floor on your house. If you got very, very rich, you might build a second floor. Who knows? But you could get up these stairs on the outside and come up onto the roof. And these friends who've come with their mate who can't walk, who've come and they've discovered they've got to the door, but they can't get in because the crowd is just so tightly pressed, they have another idea. They go out the door. They head off and they go, let's go this way. They go around the outside of the building, all the way around the outside of the building, still carrying their friend. All you people inside the building, imagine this. You just hear this sudden traipsing around. You're inside the building. You're listening to Jesus. He's trying to teach. Then you hear. And you kill the camera. Susanna, can you just grab it? Oh, Jesus is doing miracles. It's fine. We'll figure it out. Oh, we'll figure it out in a minute. For those of you watching at home, we just killed a camera. It probably didn't kill it. It's okay. Elijah's going to heal it now. The spirit and anointing of Elijah is on him. He'll raise things from the dead. They heard this sound. And imagine that. You're sitting here. Jesus, you can sit down again. It's fine. Come sit here, mate. It's great. And you're doing a good job. Elijah's on cams. He's great. No, sit here. And so you're all here listening. Imagine that. You're in the crowd. You're listening to Jesus. You're pressing in. He's trying to do some teaching. And then there's this pause because as Jesus is teaching, there's this, somebody's got up on the roof. And as you're standing, sitting there listening, there's this sound. What is going on? Something's being scraped. The mud on the roof is starting to be scraped. As you sit there, some dust starts to fall to the ground, and all the eyes lift up, not in an act of worship, but because suddenly there's a hole where there wasn't a hole before. And the banging continues, and the scraping continues, and there's excited voices, and there's much confusion, and people wondering what on earth is going on. Then all of a sudden, this person appears. Like, you've pressed in. You want to get close to Jesus, but as you look up, this pallet is being lowered to put right in front of Jesus. What astonishing faith! What an incredible act of vandalism. Seriously, they've destroyed Jesus' roof. They've taken the tiles off if there were tiles. They've cut a hole in the roof. They've lowered their friend down. I mean, how? That camera. Should we put it on the floor, Elijah? Let's do that instead. Is it still working? Amazing, it's still working. Now it's off. Tech's not a distraction in this church at all. And there's this man who's been lowered in front of Jesus. Let's just think for a second. How do you feel? How do you feel if you're somebody who's sitting there and you've come for your healing and then this person's jumping the queue? I mean, if you did that in the UK, that would be like, that's the worst sin in the world, isn't it? You cut the queue. Like, we're all here to see Jesus. Wait your turn. Maybe you're sitting here and you're one of the Pharisees and you've come to see who this Jesus is. You're one of these religious teachers and you want to kind of catch him out and, oh my goodness, he cannot run a meeting properly. Go on, judge me for the tech. I don't care. And you're sitting there and you think, look, who is this man? It's all chaotic. If you come to our worship services in the temple, in the synagogue, it's all nicely ordered. It's all proper. Everybody dresses nicely and knows how to talk. You should come to our meetings, not to this man where there's all this noise and banging and roofs and people lowering. This is disorder. This cannot be God. This is chaotic. It's messy. God can't be involved in the mess. Maybe you're the man on the mat and you're thinking, please don't drop me. Don't drop me. Maybe you're these friends who are just watching now because they still can't get in. Unless they're coming in like Paris style and they're jumping in through the gap and lowering themselves on ropes, they've lowered their friend in and that's as far as they can go now. It's now all up to Jesus and they're watching and holding their breath to see what happens next. Of course, what they're hoping happens next is that Jesus reaches out a hand to their friend who's now lying on the floor and says, be healed, and he'll get up. That's what you'd love to do, isn't it, Jesus?
Yes.
Absolutely. But that isn't what Jesus does. That isn't what Jesus does. Let's find out what you do. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. Hang on a minute. What's that about? That's a bit easy, isn't it? We've just carried him all the way here, gone up on the roof, cut the hole, disgraced ourselves in front of all of our friends, and you come up with your sins are forgiven. Can't you see he's paralyzed? And the Pharisees who are sitting here full of judgment in their heart because it's a messy place and all this chaotic stuff is going on, and now Jesus has said your sins are forgiven, and in their heart they're full of, who on earth do you think you are? Who do you think you are? You're forgiving people now, are you? This is terrible. This is disgraceful. How dare you? Big judgments in their heart. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began to themselves, who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? That means that they're insulting God. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Now, the thing I want us to see here is, everybody in this story so far thinks that the man who is paralyzed and on the mat, that his big problem is that he's paralyzed. And friends, you and I, when we meet people, in our heads, we can immediately figure out what it is that's wrong with them. Oh, you're homeless, so therefore you need this. Oh, you're in this situation in your life, that means you need this. I'm going to tell you what you need and give you what you need. Oh, you're paralyzed, that means you need to get up and walk. That's your big need right now. But Jesus is Jesus. He doesn't play by other people's agendas. He's not bothered what you think is important. He knows what's important. And he knows that whatever is going on with this man who's lying on this mat in front of him and who's paralyzed is more than just paralysis. He has got more than one problem here. And the most important thing in that man's moment right then, right there, was to hear from Jesus, not get up and walk, but I know that thing. I know that thing that is eating you away. I know that thing that you keep beating yourself up about again and again and again. I know that thing that people hold over you that you once did or you once said that you wish you hadn't done, if only you could turn back time. I know. And you know, that thing, I forgive you for it. Wow. We don't even know what it was. The Bible doesn't even tell us what it was. Only that for that man sitting on that pallet, what he needed to hear in that moment was that whatever that thing was, Jesus had freed him from it, had forgiven him, and wouldn't hold it against him or wouldn't hold it over him anymore. And Jesus knew, but he also knew what was in the hearts of the people who were watching and who were judging. And he said, what do you think is easier? To say to someone your sins are forgiven or to say get up and walk? And the mates up on the roof are saying, I think it's easier to say the sins are forgiven. We carried him here, we're hoping he's going to walk. And the crowd are maybe thinking, well, it's dead easy to say your sins are forgiven. That, you know, anybody can say that, can't they? And the Pharisees are saying, actually, we'd rather you said get up and walk than sins are forgiven, because we can, if you just heal people, then that means that you're like a healing person with a spiritual gift. But if you can actually forgive sins, that means that you're God, and we don't like that. That's what they were thinking. They were thinking that. And Jesus says, but so that you can all know I am who I say I am, so that you can know that I really do have this power to forgive sins as well, he says to the man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. And immediately, the man stood up in front of all of them. He took whatever that thing was that he'd been lying on, and he went home praising God. You can imagine the scene. Here's Jesus, and he's just spoken to the man, and the man steps up. I mean, the crowd parts so that he can make his way to the door, because you would, wouldn't you? It's like astonishing. You weren't keen on them when they arrived at the back door with all of their nose and all this, but right now you're going to get out of his way because this is like walking miracle. I was there, and now as he walks towards the door, the crowd parts and lets him go, and his heart is full of praising God. The friends on the roof get what it is that they really wanted, and they realize that what they really wanted for their friend was not actually the most important thing he needed, but he got both, and it proves something about Jesus in that moment. And everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe, and they said, we have seen remarkable things today. You betcha. What an understatement. Here's a man who can forgive sin. Here's a man who can heal the people who are paralyzed. And Ty, you've been a wonderful Jesus, and you've helped us to create a scene. Thank you very much. Please feel free to take your seat again. And he gets a warm round of applause for his Oscar-winning performance. Friends, what I want us to see in this story is that there is so much for us, and I just want to kind of just nail down what those thoughts were. The first thing is this. Look at the risks that those people took. Look at the lengths they went to, that group of friends, to get their friend in front of Jesus. And here's the challenge for you this summer. As you think about your network, your friends and relatives and associates and neighbors, your friend network, what risks are you prepared to take to bring them to Jesus? Let that be a challenge over summer, something for you to think about. Look, we're thinking about Hospitality Month that's coming up. It's a really lovely, soft, gentle way of us as church family getting to know each other. But there's a people who are just on the fringes of us as well. Those folks in our friend network who we might want to invite to one of these things and just meet people. You know, when Matthew the tax collector became a follower of Jesus, do you know the first thing he did? Somebody tell me the first thing that he did. Yeah, he had a party, and he got all of his tax collector friends and all of his newfound Jesus follower friends, and he put them in a room together just to kind of see what would happen. Hospitality Month's coming. But what lengths would you go to? What risks will you take with your reputation, with your energy, with your resources to somehow get your people in your friend network, friends, relatives, associates, and neighbors, in front of Jesus? That's the first thing. The second thing is this, and so important, was what these young men, or I'm guessing they were young, but just men, what they saw in their friend and what they perceived their friend's need to be was indeed a need, but when they came, brought him to Jesus, it was not his primary need. And it's a warning to us in this story that even with the best of our intentions, we can misread people. We don't know the whole of their story, so we need to be very careful about bringing people to Jesus and letting Jesus minister to them. Shall I tell you a controversial story? And I don't care that it's controversial because it's just beautiful. And it was about a couple when we were in our church in Northampton who got an invitation through their door to come to a Christmas service. And they were living together and they were not married. Scandalous, Jonathan. Wow. I'll tell you their names, James and Rowena. And they were lovely. And they came. And they came because we invited them to come. And they came, and on the second time they came, they both became followers of Jesus. Isn't that just incredible? And so they're there, and they're in church. They've been twice. They become followers of Jesus. They fall in love with Jesus, and they fall in love with the church. And at a leadership team meeting, one of our leaders says to the senior pastor, a man called Jeff, Jeff, you need to go and tell them to stop living together, and you need to tell them that they're living in sin. And Jeff says, I shall do no such thing, and I don't want you to say anything either. We're going to pray for them. Within a month, James and Rowena came to Jeff and said, Jeff, Do you know, we're following Jesus now and we realize there's things that are not right in our lives. And so we want to get married and we want to get married soon. We're stopped sharing a bedroom and we know that Jesus wants us to live this way. Now, there are all sorts of things in their lives that God had to deal with, but it wasn't very long and they got married very quickly and they were a lovely part of our church, James and Rowena. I was always shocked by Jeff, who was a straight down the line guy. I mean, like, he's the closest person to Jesus I've ever known personally. Trust me. He was just this holy, holy man. And I challenged him. And he said, you know, we don't know all that is going on in people's stories. We don't know the totality of this. And so in this situation, he felt it was absolutely right that we just continue to love them and pray for them and keep bringing them for Jesus and for Jesus to figure out what's going on in their lives. That takes a lot of trust, doesn't it? It really does. Because we quite like judging. We quite like telling people what they should be doing, but we need to leave that room for Jesus to do what only Jesus can do. The third thing I want us to see, so the first thing was the challenge, what risks will we take? The second thing was, let's not just judge by what we see, what people need, but let's get them in front of Jesus and see what Jesus does in their lives. And then the third thing I want us to see is this, is that Jesus forgives and Jesus heals. Oh, friends, Jesus forgives and Jesus heals. Now, we don't see so much of it today, and we're kind of thinking, why is that? And there's all sorts of thoughts about why we don't see so much of it. Some of it is we don't expect it. Some of it is we don't cry out for it. We're not desperate for it. But Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same Jesus. He still forgives. And he still heals. And it may be that you're here today and there's something that you've just been carrying and carrying and carrying. And it screws you up inside. Like you don't even want to speak it out because if people knew what you'd done, what you thought, what you said, they'd reject you, they'd have nothing to do with you, you wouldn't want to go there anymore. It's like this big stain that you carry with you the whole time. I really need you to hear this today. With all my heart, I need you to hear this today. Your sins are forgiven. Your sin is forgiven. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid the price for it. When he brought you into his family and he gave you a fresh start, he really meant it. Paul says, if anybody is in Christ, they're a whole new person. A whole new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. You need to hear it. If you're following Jesus, but you're carrying something from the past that is holding you back, that is screwing you up, that is your bitter regret that preys in your mind, let this penetrate deep into your heart. Your sin is forgiven. It's forgiven. Just thank him and let it go. And for some of us, we need to come and find our healing. And we need to keep asking and keep asking and keep asking. You know, when I was in my mid-teens, there was a season where I couldn't speak in public. My eyes were streaming. I had the heaviest of hay fever. And I was prayed for, and I didn't have hay fever for, I don't know, decades. In the last few years, there's some plants that just set me off. There's always been, lilies have always been something that set me off a little bit. But they're kind of like debilitating, eyes streaming, nose pouring, all that kind of horrible, eyes closed. That just left straight away. Amazing. I prayed for people who were infertile, who had children, even though Susanna and I, for years, were infertile and struggling to have children. It's this weird thing. Some people we pray for get healed, and sometimes it doesn't happen. So should we stop praying? Should we stop asking? No. Heck, I'll pray for 1,000 people, and if one of them gets healed, hallelujah. And I'll pray for 1,000 more, and if only another one gets healed, then hallelujah, because I'm guessing that one wouldn't have got healed otherwise. I'll take the 1 in 1,000. I'd love it to be 10 in 100. I'd love it to be 50 in 100. Imagine it was 2/3 of the people. I'll tell you this. 0 of the people you don't pray for, you know? If you've never prayed for healing, you'll never see one. Jesus forgives and Jesus heals. And it may be that you're here today and you need a healing, or maybe you're here today and you need to start trusting God for healing for people in your friend network. Here's the amazing thing, and here's the last bit. In this summer, I want you to realize that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, that was active in his life and ministry, is the Spirit that came into you the moment you became a follower of Jesus. And as you get baptized in the Spirit, is in you in increasing measure till you are full and overflowing. Which means that you can pray for the sick and they'll recover. Which means that you don't have to bring them to church and have me do it, or Steve do it, or Susanna do it, or Ruth do it, or somebody else, but you do it. You pray for the sick and see what happens. You put your hands on the shoulder of those who need Jesus and see what happens. Oh, it's all challenging and lovely, but this incredible story tells us. What risks will we go to? Can we be people who don't judge what people need? Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That means he forgives and he heals, and finally, he wants to do it through you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this incredible story. We love it. We read it as kids, and some of us read it first time as adults, but it's one of those stories that just captures the imagination. And we pray that you would teach us through it all that you want us to learn today. And Father, we pray that you would make us risk takers for the sake of your kingdom. Not just willful vandals for the fun of it, but Lord, that we'd be willing to pay the price and to do what it takes to bring our friends, our relatives, our associates and neighbors into your presence. Lord, would you fill us with faith afresh, with daring, with courage, that we would trust you and see you do remarkable things, just as we read of today. Father, would you anoint us afresh by your Spirit? Give us the power, Lord, to live for you and to serve you in our whole lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we're going to finish with one song, and it's a song called Jireh. Jireh comes from one of the names of God in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, sometimes something would happen and it would reveal something of God's character. And so we get all these kind of different names, these Hebrew names for God. And one of those is Jehovah Jireh, which means God provides. God provides. And he provides all that we need. And so this song, Jireh, picks up on the idea of the God who is a provider. Let's worship together.
Okay, thank you everyone for coming this morning. There's tea and coffee here. And if you want prayer for anything, then come down into this corner. We've got Steve, Bethan, willing and ready to pray. And thank you, Lord, for this morning. Thank you for the word that was shared. I guess we remember it and reflect on it during this week ahead and stir within us anything that you want us to especially change or act upon. And may you bless us all in the week ahead. Amen.